Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat siang semuanya. And very good afternoon to everyone who is watching this podcast on YouTube and Zoom. Okay, my name is Prebri Doni. I'm a lecturer in the Department of Biology, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, Universitas Padjadjaran. So, a little bit disclaimer. So today I'm gonna be using bahasa Indonesia dan juga bahasa Inggris ya. Dan firstly I would like to thank to the Dean of the Postgraduate Studies Universitas Padjadjaran for inviting me to this very important podcast series. Alright, today I'm gonna be discussing about the microbial contribution for rice production. So I'm gonna be presenting about how microbes can enhance rice productions, yeah, for sustainable rice productions. Okay, ini a little bit my brief introduction, yeah. I did my master and PhD at the University Kebangsaan Malaysia di Selangor, Malaysia. And then after completing my PhD, I moving to University Malaya to do my postdoc there. And then actually, as you can see my background, yeah, I have been working on the rice and microbe interactions for about 10 years now, yeah. Started from when I did my first degree at the Universitas Negeri Padang in West Sumatra, yeah. So my expertise are mycology, plant pathology, plant microbe interaction, system of rice interaction, system of rice intensification, sorry, and also agroecology. My Scopus H index currently have 10 Scopus H index, yeah. So if you are interested to, maybe if you are a student and if you have something to ask and if you are interested to join my research, you can contact me. I already display my contact, my phone number and WhatsApp, also email. You can just drop me email or you can send me WhatsApp. Okay, so we're moving to the topic today is rice, yeah? So actually, I'm very excited today to be presenting because I'm gonna be discussing two of my favorite subject, rice and microbes. So this is the rice, yeah. So we know that rice is the most important crop, yeah, in the world, yeah. About half of world population right now are consuming the rice, yeah. Around 2.5 billion people are depending on rice as their main calorie source, yeah. So the problem is that actually the rice production is stagnant over the decade, yeah. Since 2008 and 2009 until now, actually rice production is a little bit stagnant. While as you can see in the graph that in the graph show on the of my PowerPoint is that the rice price is actually increased. So there is some things not good happening here. While the rice production is stagnant and the rice price is increased. So there are many factors, yeah, as you can see in the screen that there are many factors affecting rice productions globally, yeah. Firstly, is the environmental factors. The environmental factors are very critical for rice productions because currently the global warming and then in some area of Indonesia also drought and in the coastal area we have problem with the saltwater intrusion that make the rice productions decrease. So other than environmental factors, we also have a problem with pests and diseases, especially leaf blight, sheath blight, and there are many diseases right now are affecting the rice productions, also the pests, the insects are very destructive. As well as the use of excessive use of agrochemical products like fertilizer, chemical fertilizer, and then we use a lot of pesticide, which really can kill the beneficial microbe, beneficial insects in the environment. So actually, the use of excessive agrochemical products led to the to some extent, the decrease in rice productions. Okay, and last but not least, also on the loss of soil fertility. Okay, right now, because we use excessive fertilizer, chemical fertilizer that makes the soil become infertile. Okay. A little bit highlight about the what's happening right now on the agricultural sector, especially after the COVID pandemic. Yeah, rice and agriculture sector is particularly important in Africa and Asia. Yeah, where around in Asia, in Africa, around 49 and in and 30.5. Yeah. Respectively, that the employment share by the agricultural sector. This means that agricultural sector is very important. And then the especially for women, yeah, actually the agricultural sector is the major source of employment, who account around 41.9% of agricultural workforce in the developing world, including Indonesia, yeah. And then the COVID make the decline in agricultural and labor supply, yeah? As you can see in the graph and in the picture I show showing now. Also, the impact of COVID makes a problem in the disrupt the sowing and planting and harvesting and also the marketing. Yes, this is a little bit also the impact of the COVID to the global economy, yeah. Since it started in China in December 2009, the outbreak of COVID has spread to more than 100 countries, yeah? Endangering both live and livelihood of millions. And then there are also COVID result in the global loss, yeah? And also in many countries, GDP declined in agriculture, fisheries, forestry, and so on. And currently, this is the prior the COVID. There are more than 1 billion people that are starving. There will be an estimated more than 200 million more people could go hungry in the end of 2022. Okay, this is the undernourishment and maps. Yeah? As you can see, that is really a problem with the hunger everywhere in the world. Yeah. This is the undernourishment maps. As you can see, that's actually we have a problem also in Indonesia, where the hunger around 5 until 15%. Yeah, as you can see in the picture that I'm showing right now. So my question to you all who are watching this, yeah. How we are going to feed the world? How we are going to feed the world? We already make a lot of effort into increasing the food productions, but we actually failed to feed the world with our current agricultural policies. So how are we going to feed the world? Okay, according to UNDESA, there will be 10 billion people on the earth by 2050. So how we can feed a growing planet? That's the biggest question that we need to be able to address now. So I will introduce to you all about agroecology. So how we're going to feed the world through agroecology. Okay, what is agroecology? Agroecology is the application of ecological principles in designing and managing the agricultural systems. So it means that the whole agroecology will cover the whole supply chains, yeah, from the farm to the consumers. So we need to design the environmental, we need to design the agricultural systems, using ecological principles. That's agroecology. So these are the benefits of the agroecology. Firstly, it's an increased ecological resilience, of course, because the agroecology is very eco-friendly. And then the agroecology also can improve health and nutrition, because we in agroecology we supporting the use of the biofertilizer, for example. We use local raw materials for biofertilizer, for example. And then agroecology also can conserve biodiversity and natural resources, yeah, such as soil organic matter, water, crop, genetic diversity, and natural enemies of the past, because we manage the agricultural system using ecological principles. And then agroecology also can improve economic stability, as well as can mitigate the effect of climate change. So there are some examples of agroecological practices. Yeah. We have conservation agriculture, system of rice intensification, integrated pest management, organic farming, integrating farming, biofertilizer and biopesticide. So today I'm going to be highlighting the last one on biofertilizer and biopesticide, but in the context of rice productions. Okay, this is the agroecology, applying microorganisms. The agroecology, we applying ecological principles to agricultures. One of the ways to increase food production and soil health is by applying beneficial microorganisms. So I'm gonna be highlighting how the microbe can increase food production, can increase rice productions. And I'm gonna be highlighting from the earlier views, yeah, from the 1970s until now, from the conventional kind of methodology until now, we are using omics approach in understanding the interaction between microbes and rice. Okay, this is the microbe, this is the rice. Yeah, as you can see that actually in the soil also there are many beneficial microbes. So if we maintain the soil health in good conditions, and then the microbe in the soil will be flourish. So so this is very important for us to keep our soil healthy by applying, for example, organic fertilizer and sustainable amendments, yeah, such as compost, yeah, and manure, for example. This is the if we look back in the 1970s, yeah, we can see this study from the 1970, yeah, published by Iwao Watanabe in 1970, that show that the in the rice root can be colonized by microbes. Okay, you can see here. This is the earliest study on how microbes actually can enhance the rice growth. Yeah. And then we move on to the 1990s. Yeah, we have a very good friend of mine, yeah, Prof. Frank Dezo, yeah, from Michigan State University, and his colleague from Egypt, yeah, Youssef Yani. They did a lot of studies in 1990s. Yeah, on the increasing rice, improving rice production in Egypt using rhizobia. These researchers are very, very active in the 90s. That these researchers show that the rhizobia enhanced the rice production and growth. And as you can see also in the graph, in the picture I'm showing to you now, that microbes actually be able to colonize the rice roots and then increasing rice productions. And then in the 2005, yeah, we have a very breakthrough study done by Peng Qi, a good friend of mine from China, also Peng Qi collaborated with Frank Dezo, yeah, and studying how microbes, yeah, entering the rice root and moving upwards to the other organs, and subsequently increasing the rice growth and yield. This is quite advanced study using compical laser scanning microscope. As you can see, a microbe rhizobia, yeah, in this regard, a rhizobia actually be able to colonize the rice organs. It's not only in the roots, but also rice, also microbes are moving upwards to the other organs, and then subsequently increasing the both physiological and molecular characteristic of rice that led to the enhancement of yield. And then this is the graph, yeah, actually showing that microbes, rhizobia, were really having good colonization in rice, yeah. And then how about the yield? Yeah, we already talked about the rice, the microbe increasing the growth and can colonize the rice root and everything. So how is that? How microbe can enhance the rice yield? Yeah, how many percent that microbes increase the rice yield? Yeah, we actually have summarized this data. We already published a review paper on this. Yeah, published around six months ago, yeah. So it showed that actually microbe enhance rice yield, yeah, up to 30%, yeah, as you can see in this table. So there is a potential in microbial studies that microbes can increase rice yield, yeah. So without using chemical fertilizer and toxic chemical fertilizer, we still can increase rice production using a more eco-friendly approach, which is using microbes. So I have highlighted the study done by others researchers, yeah, but right now I'm going to highlight my study. Yeah. I've been working on this microbes, yeah, namely Trichoderma asperellum SL2. I've been working on these microbes for about 7 years now, yeah, studying how Trichoderma enhance rice growth, physiological characteristic and yield, as well as how Trichoderma increase the gene expression in rice plants. Yeah. In 2014, yeah, we managed to isolate very good Trichoderma isolate, yeah, Asperellum SL2. It's very, very potential in increasing rice growth, as we have done very comprehensive research to understand how Trichoderma enhance the growth and yield, physiological traits, nutrient uptake, and also gene expression in rice plants. So as you can see in the figures that I'm showing to you now, that Trichoderma and without Trichoderma, okay, we'll see you the result. So the rice plants treated with Trichoderma exhibited a higher plant height, okay, leaf number, root phrase weight, canopy phrase weight, root biomass, and also biomass. As you can see in the figure showing to you now, that the rice with Trichoderma inoculation actually having really powerful growth components compared to control plants. Interestingly, also we also investigated the physiological changes in the rice plants upon the inoculation of the Trichoderma. Yeah, we know that photosynthesis is a very important characteristic in physiological plant physiological, yeah. And then by using trichoderma, we can increase the physiological characteristic significantly compared to control. Then also you can see in the figure, in the table, that trichoderma enhance stomatal conductance. Stomata is really important organ because that stomata can capture the CO2 that will be utilized by microbe for photosynthesis. By inoculating the rice plant with trichoderma, the stomatal conductance is actually higher. Interestingly, the internal CO2 concentration and transpiration rate of rice plant inoculated with trichoderma is a little bit significantly lower than the control plants, because that trichoderma enhance the water use efficiency, yeah? Because although the stomatal conductance is really higher, but the rice plants manage to convert the CO2 into sugar. So that's why the transpiration rate and CO2 concentration, rice plants inoculated with trichoderma lower than the control. It means that the water use efficiency in such a plants is better than control. Okay. We have published these findings in the Symbiosis, yeah, 2017. Yeah, you can read the paper. Now we're moving on to the field. Yeah, we know that the trichoderma in the greenhouse. Yeah, here's the greenhouse. Yeah, this is the greenhouse. That we want to know how the performance of trichoderma in the field. So we have done the trial in the field. As you can see here, that's actually trichoderma exhibited higher physiological characteristic like photosynthesis, where trichoderma plants are greener than the control plants. Now this is the field trial that we have done. Yeah, we firstly formulated the trichoderma using corn kernel as a delivery carrier, and then we inoculated the rice plants with the corn. Yeah, you can see here, and then we compared the rice with and without trichoderma in terms of the yield component, growth component, and physiological traits. Yeah, as you can see in the graph, trichoderma inoculated rice plants exhibited higher grain yield, 30% higher than control. So the trichoderma can actually increase the rice production up to 30%, which is a good thing to have, yeah. Because right now, as I previously explained, that we have a problem with the chemical fertilizer. So the trichoderma-based biofertilizer can be a substitute for the toxic chemical fertilizer. This is the physiological traits of rice plants treated with trichoderma, where the physiological characteristic are really, really better, yeah? As I have explained previously, like photosynthetic rate, stomatal conductance, internal CO2 concentration, transpiration, and also chlorophyll contents. And then we're asking about the gene expression, all right? We know that trichoderma enhance the yield, the growth, and the physiological characteristics. So what's happened in the molecular in the cell, yeah, of the rice when we treated the rice plants with trichoderma? So we studied this, yeah. We elucidate the gene expression pattern enhanced by trichoderma. There are many beneficial genes, yeah, correlated with the photosynthesis, ROS metabolic process, yeah, leaf development, stomatal complex development, and many genes, many beneficial genes are upregulated, yeah, when we treated the rice with the trichoderma compared to control. This figure show that the up and down regulated genes in rice, yeah, related to functional genes. Okay, and this is the graph and the figure showing that the up and down regulated of rice genes, yeah, related to molecular functions. So in the red, in the blue is the control, and the red is trichoderma. Yeah? Trichoderma is really enhanced the gene expression patterns in rice plants. Yeah. And then how about the gene related to the cellular components? Of course, also trichoderma enhance the genes, beneficial genes that are related to the functional genes related to cellular components. Yeah? We have genes related to thylakoid, cytoplasm, chloroplast. These genes are very functional. They're involved in the cellular activities in rice. So it's really, trichoderma is really powerful. It's not only can enhance the yield growth, but also can do something in the molecular level. So we published this, yeah, a few years ago on Journal Plant Growth Regulation. Yeah, I can give a pre-copy if you're asking me. I already give you my email. Yeah? You just drop me email if you have question. Yeah? Also, if you wanna have a soft copy of our published journals. Okay. So we highlighted the I highlighted the cellular changes happening in the rice, yeah, after we inoculated with trichoderma. So how is actually the rice and microbe interact? Yeah? That's the next question that we need to address. So fortunately, one of my PhD students right now in University Malaya in Kuala Lumpur are studying this. So she's doing the study on the how trichoderma initiate crosstalk communication with rice root, and how trichoderma from the soil move to the rice rhizos pair, and then entering the rice root and colonizing the rice organ. So one of my students at the University of Malaya is right now is studying this. Yeah. So I can highlight some result from that. Yeah. Actually the trichoderma produce a chemical compounds, a bioactive compounds, namely effectors or elicitor, we call it. Yeah. And then these effectors are recognizable by the rice root that can be recognized by rice roots. Upon recognizing by rice root, the signal, and then rice root exuded some chemical compounds that will attract the trichoderma to colonize the rice root. After that, the trichoderma can enter the rice root, yeah, because the rice root receptors can recognize the trichoderma, the bioactive compounds produced by trichoderma, and then trichoderma are moving inside the rice root and moving upwards to rice organs, which subsequently enhance the rice growth and yield. This is but our study that we are doing now with my student at University Malaya haven't published yet, but we have a nice, very fine study published by Wu et al. our Chinese colleague, yeah, studying the how rhizobia, Sinorhizobium, can enter the rice root. Yeah, so basically it's the same things that Trichoderma does. Yeah, but here the researchers already identified that what kind of elicitors or effector produced by the microbes, and then the researchers also identified the rice receptors in the roots. Yeah, firstly, the rhizobia produce bioactive compounds. Yeah, elicitors, namely elicitors and effectors, and then these bioactive compounds can be recognized by rice root receptors. Okay, the researchers already highlight here that there are some rice receptors, for example, PRR, PLS2, that can recognize the signals produced by rhizobia. And then the upon recognizing the rhizobia, there are a lot of molecular changes happening in the rice, like there are many genes are being upregulated, especially genes related to metabolisms, cell wall expansion, also genes that can encode it, that can encode the hormones, yeah, phytohormones. So after manipulating modulating the signals in rice organs, the rice growth and yield will be increased. Yeah, so as the result of the molecular changes modulated by the beneficial microbes. Okay, so there is the conclusion. Yeah, where the microbes, yeah, like bacteria, fungi, and then virus, yeah, we have some viruses also, can enhance the rice yield production, rice tolerance to biotic and abiotic stresses, yeah, also by applying microorganisms, the nutrient uptake, nutrient acquisitions, and water use efficiency are also increased. So we have published a paper a few months ago summarizing all this result. Yeah? Okay, you can download for free, yeah, because this from the open access journal. Okay, if you're asking me, how about the study? Does the study just in the lab? Yeah, no. We already promote the use of Trichoderma for farmers applications. Yeah, we have designed a very simple method to produce the Trichoderma, yeah, that can be used by farmers, that can be applied by farmers to increase their crops, yeah, not only rice. Yeah. So we have developed a very simple farmer-friendly method for producing the Trichoderma-based biofertilizer. Okay, a few years ago we have done quite many workshop. Yeah, we have a participant from North Korea, from Thailand, and from Malaysia, of course. Okay, thank you.